Well, I'm really excited about the message today. You know how it is when you've got to be the person to deliver bad news, but it's really great when you get to deliver good news. This is all good news. The title of the sermon is Great Is Thy Faithfulness. And keep in mind that song as we discuss these things. I actually had thought about seeing if Linda would sing it after the sermon because it ties in so well, but she doesn't like to do that. She wants to get it out of the way. So the title of the sermon is Great Is Thy Faithfulness. And the alternate title, if you're bilingual and you speak redneck, the alternate title is Don't Be Scared. And scared is S-K-E-E-R-E-D. You can look it up in my dictionary. Faithfulness is unfailing, consistent loyalty. That's what God is to us. He's unfaithfully, consistently loyal to us. Part of the equation is we have to be loyal to Him. You know, we serve an awesome, loving, protective Heavenly Father. And our elder brother, He and our elder brother, Jesus Christ, loved us so much that Jesus Christ gave His very life for us. And the other part of that equation is that the Father gave His Son. So that's, you know, that's a huge sacrifice on both of their parts. And we're so very, very blessed in so many incredible ways. Just hold that thought. I do have a couple one-liners here that a friend of ours emailed to us. One of these is regarding New Year's resolutions, which I basically have always thought it's not a real good idea, but and this one person said, my goal for 2017 was to lose 10 pounds. Only 15 pounds to go. Another one, I like this one. A recent study has found women who carry a little extra weight live longer than men who mention it. So you guys might want to keep that in mind. Okay, so back to the subject at hand. You know, we live in a really evil world. Seems like in years past, most of the places where we've attended church, sometimes you go to church, you live the whole week in the evil world, getting beat up all week long, and then you go to church and sometimes you get beat over the head with what an evil world it is. We already figured that out. You know, let's move on to some good news. So that's what we've got today is good news. Even though we live in an evil world, we don't have to be afraid because we serve an awesome, loving God. He loves us incredibly. And we're the children of that Most High God, and we have God's royal blood flowing through our veins. Great is His faithfulness. Let's turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9. I love this verse. 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9. You know, I love to go out at night and look at the stars on a clear night. I know back several days ago, early part of this week or maybe last week, I went out and I was just in awe of how vibrant the stars are. And we live on the west edge of Gladewater, so even though Gladewater is just a little town, but still the lights, you know, from the town kind of obscure the light of the stars. We've got some property 3 miles west of Gladewater, and I'm just shocked out there. When I'm out there at night, I look up at the stars and how much more clear you can see the stars, how many more you can see. But to me, that's one of the most inspiring things there is to look up on a clear night at the stars, and especially if you're out in the middle of nowhere in New Mexico or Arizona, and it's just mind-boggling. And that is the God that created us for Him and His elder brother, our elder brother. That's the God we serve. That's just amazing. So 2 Chronicles chapter 16, 9. For the eyes of the Lord search to and fro across the whole earth to show Himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal or faithful to Him. And, you know, what an incredible statement and promise. And I think I've mentioned this here before, but, you know, the part in the King James, it says loyal to Him, I think. And no, in the King James, it says perfect toward Him. And so, you know, I'd read that and I've had like, well, I'm not perfect, so I don't know if that really I fit into that category or not. But if you look it up, the word loyal or faithful is more appropriate. None of us are perfect, so if you had to be perfect, that would kind of disprove this verse, because none of us are perfect. But the objective is to be loyal or faithful to God. So my purpose today is to remind us all of God's faithfulness to His people. And I always like stories, and I've got a couple stories to share or more. So I hope to encourage you to remember God's intervention in your lives. I know my stories. I don't know your stories. There are not very many of them, but as I tell my stories, please call to remembrance your stories and how these things connect with you. You know, God knows each of us. We each have a relationship with God. And you know how it is with yourselves, between husbands and wives or friends, that if you've been together very long, and you can picture any given circumstance, and you have a pretty good idea how your wife or your mate is going to react to that circumstance. Or same thing with your friends. It's the same way with God. If we have a personal relationship with God, and we do, then we know how He's going to act or react, and He's got a pretty good idea of how we're likely to act or react. But He is perfectly faithful. Let's turn to Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 27. And this is, you know, it's quite a few verses here, and I thought about, well, we may just kind of skip through it, and we might skip through it some. But you know what? This is an awesome story, and this message is in here for a reason. So let's turn to Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 27. And while you're doing that, I'd like to say hi and welcome everyone watching on the webcast. It's really nice to have you all join us each week. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, spoken of here in Daniel chapter 3, they had that personal relationship with God. That's why they knew they could say what they said. Let's start reading in Daniel chapter 3. And you know, some of these things we've read most of our lives, most of us, and if we're not careful, it can become trite. But try to look at things with a fresh perspective. Not that it's any different than we always thought, but the point is that sometimes we just get used to reading the same thing over and over, and it's just like it kind of goes in one ear and out the other. Starting at verse 13, Daniel chapter 3. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in rage and fury, gave the command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And so they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spoke, saying to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the gold image that I have set up?" Verse 15, "Now if you are ready at the time you hear the sound of the horn, flute, harp, lyre, and psaltery in symphony with all kinds of music, and you fall down and worship the image which I have made, good. But if you do not worship, you shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is this God who will deliver you from my hands?" So Nebuchadnezzar is basically saying, okay, I'm going to give you guys, I like you guys, I'm going to give you a second chance. And I love their Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's answer. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, verse 16, answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and He will deliver us from your hand, O king." So the king just came down quite a few notches in the status here, because he's got somebody over him, it's been pointed out, and it's Almighty God. Verse 18, "He will deliver us, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury, and the expression on his face changed toward Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. And he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their trousers, their turbans, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because of the king's command was urgent, the furnace was exceedingly hot. The flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished, and he rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, "Did we not cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire?" They answered and said to the king, "True, O king." "Look," he answered, "I see 4 men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God." Sends chills up my spine. Then Nebuchadnezzar went near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spoke, saying, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out." And notice Nebuchadnezzar's had a little bit of change of heart here. Now they're servants of the Most High God, the ones he just tried to burn up. "Come out and come here." Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came from the midst of the fire, and the satraps, administrators, governors, and king's counselors gathered together. And they saw these men on whose bodies the fire had no power. The hair of their head was not singed, nor were their garments affected. And the smell of fire was not on them. So talk about bold. You know, Nebuchadnezzar, you know, he's being a good-hearted guy, I guess, good-hearted king. "Hey, look, I'll give you a second chance, kind of like you guys." And they say, basically, they say, "We don't serve your God. He's just a hunk of metal. We serve the Almighty God." I just love their courage in that and their trust in God. So how trusting is our relationship with God? Do we have that same core trust in God, that to trust and obey Him and to trust Him in everything, no matter what the circumstances look like? Just like the song said, "Stand still." You know, there's times when we need to stand still. There's other times God's not an enabler. He doesn't do for us basically what we can and should be doing for ourselves. I remember when I was growing up in Indiana, where Charles and I attended church, went to a friend's house for a weekend, and they had 3 sons. The middle son was my friend, and he had a younger brother that was 3 or 4 years younger. I think I was probably 11 or 12. The younger brother, who would have been about 8 or so, the next morning comes to the breakfast table in his underwear and his tighty-whities, and he's sitting there. His mother fried some eggs, and he's sitting there, "Mom, I can't do this. You're going to have to cut it for me, the egg." I'm like, I was just appalled. Really? You're 8 years old, sitting at the table in your underwear, and your mommy's got to cut your egg? God doesn't cut our egg. When we're sitting there at the table in our underwear, God's not going to come cut our egg for us. But He will do for us what we can't do, and He will show Himself strong for us. How many of you have been to the feast in Jekyll Island in the early years there? What years? I know when Charles was there, about there. Well, I know, our family attended Jekyll Island the first time the feast site was held there in 1963. And this has had my attention ever since then. Actually, in the Indianapolis church where we attended, I think that was the first year or second year. I know one of those 2 years, Indianapolis church was scheduled to go to Jekyll Island. We were both of those years, but there was a hurricane coming through, and we were told, well, we don't know if the feast is going to be there or not. So they told the Indianapolis church congregation, go to Cincinnati for the Holy Day for atonement, and then we'll tell you on atonement where you will go from there. Were you there that year or not? Okay. So we all go to Cincinnati, and then they said, okay, go on to Jekyll Island. But the problem was a hurricane that was projected to hit Jekyll Island, and I think that was the year that it did hit, and it tore the roof off the Wanderer Hotel and did some other damage. I've seen that happen before the feast. I've seen it happen after the feast. I've never seen that happen during the feast. I'm pretty sure there's a reason. But that really got my attention that year, and I've seen this, like I said, over and over and over again at feast sites, that whether it's hurricanes or tornadoes or what the problem is. And year after year, time after time, every single time, I've seen God protect his people at the Feast of Tabernacles as a whole. And you can even get online, which I've done some, you can get online and look up that hurricane, which is pretty fascinating. And I remember one time there was a hurricane that came across Cuba. We were meeting in Jekyll Island this time. A hurricane came across Cuba, was headed toward Jekyll Island, and then it turned around and went back across Cuba, and then it just stayed at bay. And then I don't remember if it came on through the Jekyll Island area or where it was, but that's just one more example. Was anybody here in Ocho Rios, Jamaica, for the Feast of Tabernacles in 2001, right after 9/11? Or if anybody watching on Cybercast was, I would really appreciate it if you would write in and mention that you were there. But I want to share this story with you, which is, my wife and I have been in a tornado or more than one tornadoes, and been driving, mostly driving in the area where there's tornadoes on the ground, and you're in a different state, which is pretty scary. But we've been in an earthquake, been through a hurricane. So I want to tell this account, this personal account of being in Ocho Rios at the Feast of Tabernacles in 2001. We were really apprehensive about, our daughter was, Tiffany would have been, well, she was in college at the time. She was roughly 19 probably, and our son would have been 22. My wife's giving me the numbers here. So anyway, our daughter was in college, and our son was about that age too. And so, but this was right after 9/11, and you know, there was travel advisory about going outside of the United States because of the terrorism threat. And so we debated quite a bit if we still wanted to go to Jamaica for the feast. We absolutely were going to keep the feast. It was a matter of where we were going to do it at. But we decided to go ahead and go to Jamaica for the feast, which is when I officially started liking sitting in the back of the plane, because you see what's going on and you get a blanket or a belt or something if you need to and use it to subdue somebody. But so we go to Jamaica. Everything's great. Having a good feast, good messages. And we watched CNN fairly often in our motel room to see what was going on the world scene as far as terrorism, because the United States was in the process of going to war. And eventually we discovered there was a tropical storm brewing out in the Pacific, out east of the Dominican Republic and Haiti. So, we didn't think too much about it. You hear about tropical storms pretty regularly. Of course, not regularly out in the middle of the ocean on an island either. So, eventually this storm gets stronger and stronger. Eventually it gains hurricane status. And as a hurricane, it crosses over the Dominican Republic and killed three people there. And it's headed straight for Jamaica. And Jamaica's, if you don't happen to know, it's south of Cuba and a little bit east, I think. And then Dominican Republic is pretty much straight east of that. And so we start watching this on the news, and it's getting to be a big deal. And every time they showed it on the news on CNN, they would draw a red line under Cuba because they expected it to hit the south coast of Cuba. They draw a red line under the Dominican Republic because they expected it to hit there, and it did. And then we're right here on Jamaica, and they would just draw a red circle around, all the way around Jamaica. And this hurricane was 8 times bigger than the island of Jamaica. So it's kind of gets your attention. So this became a pretty considerable threat. So the manager of the resort, and there was about 700 rooms there in that resort, we didn't know it at the time until the feast was about over. There were, I think, six different Church of God groups meeting at that same resort for the Feast of Tabernacles. And the manager of the resort, this became a very serious threat. He called a meeting for everybody staying at the resort to meet in the largest meeting hall there, which happened to be the one we were meeting in. And he had, I think it was a two legal page list of everything we were all supposed to do. And they had been hit by a serious hurricane, I think, 2 or 3 years before that. So this was all taken very seriously. We were all supposed to go back to our room, take all of our luggage, pack it up, put it in the bathroom, fill the bathtub up full of water. If you had hurricane shutters, shut your hurricane shutters, and then spend the night in the hallway out there, which is, you know, the best protected because it's in the middle of the building. And so after that meeting, several of us, jumping back to Jekyll Island, I was 11 years old that first feast there, and I've seen God's hand at work. The head usher, we started sharing stories about God's protecting his people at the Feast of Tabernacles. The head usher told me his story that when he was, I think he was about 10, I don't remember what year this was, they were at the Poconos feast site, and I think they had a tent, I think he said they had a tent there at that time. And he told the account, and I vaguely remember this account, that they were having services, Mr. Ted Armstrong was speaking, and there was a tornado headed straight for the tent. And Ted Armstrong rebuked the tornado, and it split in half and went around the tent and then joined back together, and they had aerial photographs of that, of the destruction of the trees and the path, on the front page of the paper the next day. Are any of you familiar with that story? Okay. And by the way, I'd love to hear your stories. So back to Jamaica. And so we all shared stories with each other about just like this, of how God is faithful to his people. And then it was also all inclusive there. So, all the food you want. Also, that also included drinks. And so being good church members that we are, we were very serious about doing our part, taking care of our, our belongings and our lives. And then we did, then some of us went, they set up an emergency center in the library there at the resort. And I was trying to get a feel for how seriously the people, the employees of the resort took it. So I just went around and casually talked to several of them about it, and they took it very seriously, and they were pretty scared. And the guy, and I talked to the guy in charge of the emergency center, and he was pretty scared about it. And so, but I told him, don't worry about it. The hurricane's not going to hit us. And I just took not sure it's an educated or uneducated guess. I said it's going to come right toward Jamaica, and it's going to veer off to the south, go around Jamaica, and then continue on its path. It's not going to hit us. He goes, really, you think so? And I said, yeah, I know so. And that's exactly what it did. And so, anyway, so, we make all the preparations, go on checking on things in the emergency center there, go outside, you get drinks out there. And we got, a little bit of drink, not too much, just enough. Which ties in with another one-liner I've got to throw in here. All right, we got a taker. We've got one here thanks, Wesley. We've got one person online that was sent a note that they were there in Jamaica that year. Congratulations. It was pretty awesome, wasn't it? So, okay, this guy goes to a dentist, and the dentist told him he needed a crown. And he said, you bet, pour mine on the rocks. So that's how that ties in with. So we had a crown or something similar. But what happened was, and I stayed up most of the night. We were able to stay in our room because our room did have hurricane shutters on it. And I kept the TV on. I think went back to the room about 2 o'clock in the morning. They expected, the manager of the resort said, his exact words were, barring a miracle, we will be hit by this tornado about 5 o'clock in the morning. So, and when the meeting was done by the manager of the resort, the the guy in charge of the feast for the group we attended with, went up to the microphone. He said, "You people in the church, you know what to do," which was to pray. and we all did, pretty seriously. But during the night, I went back to the room about 2 o'clock in the morning. During the night, the wind got really violent. It's kind of like taking your whole world and put on a flatbed truck and drive that truck between 75 and 150 miles an hour or more. That's the potential there. But Lynn and I were in our room, and then our son and daughter were in the room right next door. It got really windy that night. You could hear the wind howling. And 5 o'clock comes and passes. We're all still there. And God spared us. The hurricane veered off to the south, went straight on, and then it went to the Yucatan Peninsula of Mexico and killed, I think, 12 or 15 people there. But that was a pretty awesome experience. And by the way, the airports were shut down too. You were there for the duration. It didn't matter. Unless you thought you were going to swim to the mainland, however, 100 miles away or something, you were there. So God loves us immensely. And if we're not careful, we can be totally oblivious to what he does in our lives. It'll be interesting one of these days to see what all God's done on our behalf that we were totally oblivious to. But we need to pay attention to that and praise God and thank God for that. No telling how many blessings that we don't receive because we're too careless not to look at what God has done for us. We just take it for granted and go on. God likes to be praised, and I'm sure it's not because, I know he's not an egomaniac. I think it's for our own good so that we know we need to look to God. Let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. We really need to meditate on the things that God does in our lives, and not just for ourselves, but to share those stories with others for their encouragement. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 9. Therefore, know that the Lord your God, he is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love him and keep his commandments. So those are important ingredients right there, that we love him and keep his commandments. And I think I may have mentioned this back here, maybe on trumpets, but if you do the math, just a simple math on 1,000 generations, if you assume 20 years per generation, that's 20,000 years. And considering that apparently man's only been on earth for 6,000 years, we've got 700 generations of God's faithfulness remaining. It's not like, oh, well, that was back then, but now he doesn't get involved in our lives. Now, absolutely, he gets involved in our lives. So we've got 700 generations of God's faithfulness left, but the point is there's no limit to God's faithfulness. Even after 20,000 generations, there's still God's faithfulness. Now, I'll share this story. I'm not sure if I mentioned it in another message here or not, but if I did, it's worth repeating. A friend of mine that I've mentioned before, Eddie Landis, that Charles knew, died of cancer. Actually, he died from the chemo 25 years ago. And I've told his wife, Paula, different times over the years how clearly obvious it is to me that God has put a hedge around Paula and her two daughters. And the second daughter wasn't even born yet when Eddie died. And Paula never really, all these years, Paula never really said much about that. I don't think she even ever replied to it, actually. And they came out to Arizona to see us two summers ago. And she's since remarried, married just an incredibly nice guy. And, you know, when you lose someone like that, and that's when you're familiar with the term, well, we lost so-and-so. That term never really sunk into me like it did after Eddie died, because it truly is a loss. And I know when Linda and I were dating, Linda and I took Linda to Six Flags. Eddie lived in Indiana, and I called Eddie while we were at Six Flags. And after Eddie died, every once in a while, I would get an urge, something happened, oh, I call Eddie. And then I'm like, no, I can't. He died. And it truly is a loss. And a lot of those things we really don't understand, but we're not God. You know, why did Eddie die? I don't know. His wife and I've discussed that, and it's something I guess we'll never know in this life. But God is a good God, and Paula told me 2 years ago, she brought up the subject, you know, you've said several times that God has put a hedge around me and the girls, and I said, yes, that's right. She said, well, he has. And she went on to relate to me that that Eddie prayed faithfully to God every day that God would provide for and protect Paula and Krita and Shauna. And I never thought of it like this, but Paula made the point that, you know, God never forgets a prayer. And he's honored that prayer all these years. And sometimes it just seems so unfair. Like with Eddie had a 1.5-year-old daughter, and his wife was pregnant with their second daughter. He was a really good guy. But he died. Okay, but on the flip side of that, I bought a guitar about a year ago and started practicing it, which I need to get back to. But in my practice book, one of the songs in there is Amazing Grace, which I've just really come to love. It's a beautiful song, but I want to read the last line to you. The last verse, rather, is, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. That's a pretty awesome thought to look at it. You know, when we lose someone now or somebody going through a really difficult time, we look at it from our frail human perspective right now, that we lost this person and we don't like it. Okay, from God's perspective, 10,000 years from now, we will have been reunited with them and singing God's praises with them for 10,000 years. And it reminds me of something that over the years on having employees, I always get a kick out of this. Every once in a while, an employee will come and say, boss, we got a big problem. And whenever they say that, I just kind of smile inside because I'm thinking, no, we don't. I'm thinking, you know, I don't think so. And I don't recall a time that they've said we got a big problem, that it actually was a big problem. It's just an opportunity to use a little creativity to solve the problem. And that kind of reminds me of the way it is with God, is to us, when we lose someone, when somebody dies, that's a big problem. To God, it's not a problem. That's what he does. He gives life. He knows that, you know, we're looking at it from our frail human perspective. He gives life. He's the life giver. He gave the life initially, and he will give the life again, and we will be reunited with our loved ones. You know, we're encouraged in the Bible to give praises to God. Let's turn to Psalms chapter 89. Psalms chapter 89, verse 1. says, I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known your faithfulness to all generations. And then let's drop down to verse 8. O Lord of hosts, who is mighty like you, O Lord? Your faithfulness also surrounds you. And you know, when we like to live life, our objective is, if here's a trial, we want to go around the trial. Sometimes God leads us around a trial. On the other hand, sometimes God leads us head on right through the midst of the trial. And when he does that, I don't have the scripture here handy. You may know it, but there's different places in the Bible that states that when God leads us through a trial, he goes before us. He's not just saying, okay, there's a trial, go on. God leads the way through the trial. And then he doesn't just lead the way through the trial, he also flanks us on both sides as we go through the trial. And as if that's not enough, he also follows behind us and protects us from the rear. So we got nothing to worry about. It may be painful, but God's working with us and we're going to learn things through that trial. But he's got us surrounded and protected. I want to read Psalms 3 also while we're here in Psalms. This is about, we'll start in verse 3. This is about when Absalom was trying to kill David. Psalms chapter 3, verse 3. But you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory and the one who lifts up my head. I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I awoke for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of 10,000s of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O God, for you have struck all my enemies on the cheekbone. You have broken the teeth of the ungodly. Salvation belongs to you, Lord. Your blessing is upon your people. And remember the account of Elisha and his servant when the armies had surrounded them, and the servant, looked out in the morning and he was really frightened and scared, and he went in and told Elisha, we're surrounded. And Elisha, I think, told him to go out and look again, and God removed the scales from the servant's eyes, and he went out and looked again, and the mountains and hills were covered with the angels of the Almighty God. How many times has God done that in our lives? How many thousand years ago was that when he did this for Elisha? You'd think all those angels just been sitting around taking a break ever since then? Maybe they got stuff to do, like protecting us and being there for us, just like they do the same thing today. God does the same thing for us. So who is God faithful to? He's faithful to those that are faithful to him. You know, in marriage, a lack of faithfulness is called adultery. And that's what Israel was guilty of, was not being faithful to God. All we have to do is all that God's waited on for 6,000 years, simply to trust God and obey him, just like the song we sang. Referring back to 2 Chronicles 16:9, the eyes of the Lord search to and fro across the whole earth. Tyler is a part of the whole earth. He's searching to and fro here for those who have a loyal heart toward him. Philippians, I'll just refer to Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. It's good, too, to keep in mind that Jesus Christ, our elder brother, has already defeated evil. That's already been accomplished, which gets back to only thing left is for us to trust and obey God. It occurs to me that we spend our lives going to the Red Sea, just like the Israelites, over and over again. How many times have you been to the Red Sea? We've been there a lot, my wife and I. And when we get there, the only thing to do is not grumble and complain about where we are. Just trust in God, and he'll deliver us through every time. Now, I don't know what you're going through. Those of you here, those of you watching on the webcast, I don't know what you're going through, but I'm pretty sure you're going through something. And my wife and I are going through something right now. We're going through an incredibly blessed life. We've been through trials, but it's nice when you have a wide spot too. And we're blessed beyond measure, and that's pretty nice, but it's really nice. But those, not all of you can feel that way right now, even though when it's all said and done, I'm quite sure that we're going to realize our trials were actually our greatest blessings, because that's when God was working with us the most. And that's the way my wife and I feel, that through those trials are really difficult, and you don't know how you're going to make it through other than trusting in God. And let me tell you something. I could tell you stories the rest of the day, seriously, about how God has intervened on a regular basis in our lives. And it's pretty awesome to see. So when we get to the Red Sea, just trust in God, he'll part the sea. You know, the Israelites wanting and hoping to go around the Red Sea, like us going around the trial. God took them right through it, and he protected them. God already has the solutions to our problems before we even know we have a problem. That's pretty cool. All we have to do is simply obey God. He's got the rest. So don't be scared. Great is thy faithfulness.